US GBC, US Green Building Council, Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, so the program. So people have come from Pune and Chennai. இதுக்கான அவேர்னஸ் என்ன திருப்பூர் ரொம்ப கம்மி, பட் மல்டிநேஷனல் கம்பெனிஸ் எல்லாம் லீடு போக ஆரம்பிச்சிட்டாங்க. இதில் இந்தியன் வெர்ஷனும் இருக்கு, சிஐ கொடுக்கக்கூடிய கிரீன் கொண்ட ஒரு வெர்ஷன் இருக்குது, பட் அதுவுமே இந்த அளவுக்கு ஹோட் ஸ்போக்கன் வருது. ஸோ இன்றைக்கி பேசக்கூடிய ஃபர்ஸ்ட் டாபிக் வந்து லீடாக இருக்கும். ரெண்டாவது வந்து ஜிஹெச்இ கிரீன் ஹவுஸ் கேஸ் எமிஷன்ஸ், இல்லைன்னா கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்டிங், இல்லைனா குளோபல் வார்மிங்கிற ஆங்கிளில் பேசலாம். இப்போதைக்கு வரக்கூடிய சோஷியல் கம்ப்ளைன்ஸ்க்கு அடுத்த அப்படியே என்வாரன்மெண்டல் பேச ஆரம்பிச்சோம்னு சொன்னாக்கா நிச்சயமாக கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்டிங் கேட்குறாங்க. யாராவது ஹிக் இண்டெக்ஸ் பண்ணுறீங்களோ அது ஒரு பாயிண்ட் நிச்சயமாக வரும். கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்டிங் பண்ணுறீங்களா பண்ணீங்கிற பாயிண்ட்லாம் வரும் நிச்சயமாக. ஃபியூச்சரில் இதுக்கான கேள்விகள் அதிகமாக இருக்கும். மூணாவதாக வந்து லைஃப் சைக்கிள் அனாலிசிஸ் எல்சிஏ அப்படிம்பாங்க. ஸோ இந்த கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்டிங்கை பார்க்காத பட்சத்தில் எல்சிஏ என்ன கஷ்டம். ஸோ எல்சிஏட இம்பார்ட்டன்ஸ் என்னங்கிறத இந்த ப்ரெசன்ஸ் பண்ணுறதுக்கப்புறம் உங்களுக்கு தெரியும். ஸோ இந்த மூணு மெயின் டாப்பிக்கு உங்களோட இன்ட்ராக்ஷன்ஸ் இருக்கும் பட்சத்தில் தான் செஷனை வந்து இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங்காக போகும். ஸோ இந்த மூணு செஷன் நடத்தி கொடுக்கறதுக்கு நமக்கு இடம் கொடுத்த டீக்கு தேங்க்ஸ் சொல்லிட்டு, ஸோ லெட் இஸ் நாட் வேஸ்ட் டைம், லெட் இஸ் கோ ஸ்ட்ரெயிட் டு த டாபிக். ஐ வுட் லைக் டு இன்வைட் த மெம்பர்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் லீக் யூஎஸ்ஜிபிசி டு கிவ் த ப்ரெசன்டேஷன்ஸ் ஆன் லீக். So I would be happy to invite Saurav Gupta ji to show his presentations, and I would request the guest to be seated in the front row.
Thank you Mr. Mohan and TEA for inviting us. My name is Saurav Gupta. I am working as a senior technical manager with US Green Building Council. However, my card says I'm from GBCI. So I will just give you a brief background about what GBCI stands for. I would also like to let you know that this is my colleague, Mr. Suresh, who is basically regional head for Southern Region. So he basically takes care of regions like Tamil Nadu and Chennai. So let's come to the point, why are we here for and what are the basic agenda to get delivered for? So GBCI basically is Green Business Certification Inc. We are basically the certifying partner for LEED rating system. So LEED is one of the rating system which we certify, but there are other rating systems as well which address different kind of sustainability standards. So Suresh and myself belong to GBCI. So the topic given to us and we would like to discuss in this forum is about building efficiency in industrial sector and the role of LEED. So to give you a context about why green building is important when it comes to industrial facilities. Green building has been there over decade more in the market, and it is primarily more prevalent in the office sector in the IT industry, right? But manufacturing is bigger, very big industry in India, and we have different government schemes out there in India. Like one of the government scheme is about PAT, which is Performance Achieved Trade. It is a scheme run by Government of India and a BEE program. The aim of the scheme is to reduce the energy consumption in the industrial sector. So they have allocated various sectors into that, textile being one of the sector which is given a priority for that. The basic agenda of the scheme is to achieve a minimum energy performance by designating certain customers to reduce the specific energy consumption. When it comes to LEED, LEED is all about efficiency, whether it's energy, water, waste, it's all about efficiency. So LEED can take a role in terms of achieving those targets. And that's why we are talking why green building is more important when it comes to industrial sector. And garment being a very regular sector when it comes to LEED, Bangladesh is a common example for us. More than 500 companies alone in Bangladesh and from the garment industry is participating in the LEED certification. The learning objectives of today is I will introduce about the LEED rating system and what are the various benefits of going for LEED certification. Understanding the role of LEED in attaining building and process efficiency, right? So building efficiency is one part when it comes to HVAC, lighting and other things. The second part is the process efficiency, which any manufacturing building wants to perceive. Otherwise, the whole purpose of getting into a green building certification will be nullified. Third, we can also talk about the certifying process for industrial facilities. So there are different rating systems available with LEED. Which are the rating systems that can be applied for industrial facility, we'll talk about that. performance route to LEED certification. So recently we started with the performance monitoring tool to achieve LEED certification. So basically we have developed a tool called the ARC Score tool. It's an online based tool wherein you need to enter the data of the last 1 year, and the tool itself performs how your building is performing to various categories. So we'll take through what is the performance category and how to certify your buildings through that. And lastly, I will cover some statistics and some case studies about the garment industry. So I've introduced myself. I'm Saurabh Gupta, Senior Manager, Technical Solutions. So my primary responsibility is to handle the customers in terms of LEED registration and certification. So I primarily take care of India and Southeast Asia, and I'm based out of Pune. We'll start with the vision of USGBC, that is US Green Building Council. So we have a vision of having a green buildings for everyone within this generation. And we are transforming the way how buildings, communities and cities are designed, built and operated. We are there in almost 167 countries, and our mission is to how the buildings are designed, operated and transformed, in the sense how it incorporates various green building features into that, and we help build safer, healthier, inclusive, smart. So these all are basically interchangeably word which when we try to sell green building concepts into the market. And we work around this master's market transformation through our LEED certification rating program. So LEED standards are there in the market since almost 2 decades. So the first version of LEED was launched in 1999, the version 1. Currently we are in version 4.1. So LEED started basically in United States, and since 2008-09, the evolvement of the LEED rating system, especially into the Indian market, has evolved. Currently, we have almost 1 lakh plus commercial projects globally. In India, if I talked about the numbers, there are roughly around 3,500 registered projects in different categories of built spaces. So as I said, we have almost 1 lakh plus commercial projects. This is again an old number coming out, which is spread across 167 countries and territories. So we are almost there in every countries and territories of the world. Each day GBCI certifies 2.4 million square feet of built-up spaces. If I talk about the LEED professionals, which basically comprises of two versions, which is LEED Green Associate, which is a basic course which is run by USGBC. This basic course is basically to address the students and the people who are working into the green building industry. And second is the LEED AP, which is a professional version of that. So globally, we have around 2 lakh plus LEED GAs plus LEED APs and various other stakeholder communities involved together. Now coming to the important part, what is the value of LEED? Many people ask us why they want to go for LEED certification, why owners, developers and investors want to get into a LEED certification zone. A plaque on a building basically states our leadership. So as I said, LEED has been into the market since 20 years now, and we are the only green building rating system that has been on the regular track since 20 years. So we have different kinds of adaptation that comprises from homes to offices to IT parks to industrial to warehouse. In every sector, LEED is there. And secondly, LEED is an international standard. We adhere to various international standards like ASHRAE, ISHRAE and other things. And through the process of certification, even if your building is doing a lot of green building activities, a lot of strategies to curb down energy efficiency or maybe water consumption, LEED is a process to validate that process. So that's why more and more companies wanted to invest into LEED to get that validation, and definitely LEED attains certain brand value to it. So in a nutshell, if I describe LEED standards, so LEED standard is basically a framework which is developed by USGBC and GBCI, and this is a proven framework that helps you identify and implement various practical and measurable. So measurable word is very important here. when we talk about we are doing certain things, so how do we ensure that we are measuring those things, right? So we are providing you certain tools and resources that help you measure and benchmark your project against the other building. So we are talking about all buildings in. Now we are also talking about cities and communities. So going beyond buildings, we also have started our own rating on LEED for cities and LEED for communities. We have different kinds of rating adaptation available to serve different kinds of projects. Like we have rating system for retail, we have for hospitality, we have for warehouse. So different rating systems are there to suit the requirement of different built space type. And LEED work for all phases of development, whether it's a new building, whether it's an existing building, whether it's an interior fit out. So LEED has a rating standards available for all the built space type. It has been proven that green buildings are, have multiple tangible as well as intangible benefits. However, the key benefits when any project wants to go for LEED certification is you're trying to save money, right? When it comes to any industrial owner, saving money is the biggest part, and that is correlated with how your building is actually performing. It consumes less energy, less water, it generates less waste, it's used better materials, sustainable materials, and provided indoor environment quality. So health and wellness again is now an emerging sector, and our focus for next version of LEED would be focusing more on the health and wellness of the occupant inside the building of the rating. So we talk about what green buildings is and how can industrial facilities can play a role when it comes to achieving green building standards. So I talk about manufacturer side. From the manufacturer perspective, green buildings are highly efficient. Green buildings are highly efficient, and efficiency has a direct correlation with the profitability. So when your building tends to consume less energy, less water, definitely your operating cost and maintaining cost is reduced. And when it comes to industrial scale, it can save you thousands of dollars of money when you go through this process. And for us, virtually everything you're using on a everyday basis is manufactured at some places. So we need to question ourselves how this products are coming, from where these facilities the products are coming from. Today we are very careful about what things we use, especially when I take a product, I see the packaging material. What is the packaging material that goes into when it comes from a manufacturing facility? So it's very important to understand how these facilities are really operating. Are they sensitive to the environment, to the society in which they are operating? So green building has a play to role in those areas. So the scope and opportunity of green building is not only related to your bottom line, the scope is holistic. We are talking about the triple bottom line of the organization. And the benefit of LEED, achieving LEED is, it covers all the three aspects in a very holistic way. So there are various credits and prerequisites, which talks about people, planet, and profit together. When we talk about green building, we also talk about the health and wellness. We also talk about the economic perspective of why you should go for a green building certification. It is wisely said by one of our key stakeholders, why is LEED worth the investment? So it drives efficiency in the processes and systems. It doesn't cost too much, and the return of investment is pretty good. So it doesn't cost too much. Again, this is a very popular myth in the market that green building costs us more, right? Why it happens, I will tell you. So many of the project comes to us when the project is up and, almost in the commissioning stage, and they wanted to achieve, green building gold standards or platinum standards. And then with the limited opportunity they have, because they have left all the opportunity when it comes to design and construction. So only opportunity they are coming with using a high efficient equipment, and equipment then again cost a lot. So it's very important that you right at the right stage, when you come to green building standard, right at the design stage you start the process. Until the commissioning stage, the journey of certification will go on. Our research says LEED certified buildings are proven to have 34% lower CO2 emission, consume 25% less energy, 11% less water, and have diverted 80% million tons of waste. So these are all the the research numbers coming out. But if you think from your industrial point of view, the scale point of view, the combined effect of this can have a detrimental effect on the cost as well as on the environment and the society at large. Now let's dwell into how LEED certifies industrial buildings and spaces. As per the definition in LEED, manufacturing buildings are basically those facilities that houses machines and tools to produce goods for use or sale. Manufacturing process are the step through which raw materials are transformed into a final product. So this is basically a very general definition what LEED uses to certify industrial spaces. Whereas warehouse and distribution centers are those buildings that stores goods, manufacture products, merchandise, raw materials or personal belongings. So why I'm trying to emphasize the differentiation between manufacturing and warehousing distribution center definition is because we have a different rating that suits different, you know, built spaces. We have 21 different types of adaptation that suits different requirements. So when it's come to certifying your project, you need to understand what kind of rating is basically applicable for you. So when it comes to manufacturing and industrial building, they are basically certified under LEED BD plus C new construction for any new facilities and LEED O&M existing building for the existing facilities. When it comes to warehouse, we have a separate rating for warehouse and storage, which is called as a LEED BD plus C warehouse for a new construction and LEED O&M warehouse for the existing warehouse and distribution center. Currently, we have two versions of the rating system which is up and running, that is LEED version 4 and version 4.1. I will talk about the version in the coming slides. Also, it's very important to understand that LEED has certain requirements or certain minimum program requirement that any project needs to follow to achieve LEED certification. So LEED basically certifies a building. It cannot certify the entire campus, right? Because the rating system is developed for a building level requirement, not at a campus level requirement. When it comes to industrial building, typically any industrial building will have multiple buildings or structures within that, right? And LEED says buildings which are not physically connected to each other are considered a separate building from LEED certification point of view, until you have some sort of a programmatic dependency upon each other. So when you have multiple buildings within a campus, so it's recommended you follow the campus guidance approach. So the campus guidance itself is not a certification at all, but what we are going to do in this, if you suppose you have a corporate campus where there are multiple buildings involved, right? Like Infosys campus, you can take an example, there are multiple buildings involved. Each building want to go for a LEED certification, right? But the campus, they are sharing some campus utilities and infrastructure within that. So campus guidance does that. So campus guidance, what it does is basically approve certain campus related guidance or shared infrastructure. And then that campus credits can be attributed to the individual building certification. So it makes your life easier in terms of streamlining those certification process. When it comes to LEED version 4, so LEED version 4, I will not say the newest version of the rating system because it has been there in the market since 2013 now. But while developing LEED version 4 rating system, certain credits were developed and twisted to suit the requirement of the industrial sector and warehouse and distribution center. Like for warehouse and distribution center, the requirements are quite different than a typical office areas because the area is more suited to have kind of a storage space rather than occupancy out there. So LEED have addresses those issues when it comes to your indoor air quality, site selection and location, and the requirements are different. When it comes to industries, there are different methodologies that has been developed by us in terms of certifying those standards. The credit categories in LEED remains the same. So we have basic 8 credit categories, which are sustainable site, location and linkage, water efficiency, energy, integrative process materials, IQ, and innovation and design process. So irrespective of what rating you apply for, these categories primarily remains the same, but the specific credit requirements will change based on what kind of project you have. For example, office will have a different set of requirements than a warehouse. When it comes to application to an industrial facility, how does LEED V4 handle that? The first key things to know that LEED caters to both existing and new facility. You can certify both your new as well as your existing setup. Lead does addresses process load and savings to an extent. So as you know, any typical manufacturing facility, the process load is very high as compared to your non-process load, which is coming from your lighting and HVAC. So until you address the process load, it's very difficult to attain a minimum energy performance. Because when you go through the LEED certification, you have to achieve a minimum energy performance, right? And that is compared to international standards like ASHRAE. So until you show some savings on the process load, it will be very difficult for you to achieve the entire energy performance. So LEED has developed certain methodologies wherein a project team can demonstrate savings on those process equipment. Thirdly, by utilizing the campus guidance approach, you can leverage those campus utilities and site infrastructure and approve your campus related credits right at the design stage. Fourth, there is a myth in the market that LEED doesn't certify your naturally ventilated buildings as such. LEED does. It is slightly difficult as compared to mechanically ventilated because LEED usually follows the ASHRAE standards. And when it comes to ASHRAE is more related to HVAC, right? But having said that, ASHRAE 62.1 has those provision to cater the naturally ventilated requirement. So LEED addresses naturally ventilated factories. So if you have those naturally ventilated factories with you, come to us, we can review those from the LEED perspective. So coming to LEED version 4.1, so this is the next evolution of LEED rating system. We launched this rating system in the beginning of this year. So this rating is available for BD plus C and ID plus C. That means it is available for any new building or interior design and construction. The reason for launching this rating system was, since LEED was there into market since 2013 LEED V4, it was a time to update the standards. We were using earlier the 2013 standards. So it's a time to update the standards to 2016. And also there were many gray areas when it's come to implementation of those credits on the Indian projects. So we have simplified certain requirements and also expanded the market in terms of developing some alternate compliance paths. So basically alternate compliance paths are those paths wherein a project team is not able to achieve a certain credit with the given standards, and by developing ACPs for different countries, this path is easily available and achievable for Indian projects as such. So how can you participate in LEED version 4.1 rating system? Since LEED V4.1 rating system is currently under beta stage and it's open for registration, so you can register any LEED V4.1 project for your new building project. Or if you have any existing LEED registered project under any version, you can upgrade it to LEED version 4.1. If you don't want to use the entire LEED V4.1 platform, you can substitute few credits with the LEED version 4.1 credits. So coming back to the existing building, so it's wisely said that the greenest building in the world are already developed. By that it means we have the biggest chunk of the building into those existing building sector. We know that the building is already designed and constructed as per the green building rating, as per LEED or any other rating system. Now how do we ensure that this building is performing as per the standard, right? So we launched a certain rating system called LEED version ONN rating system. So until a year and a half back, certification for an existing building was a challenge when it comes to LEED, because the project team has to document several credits and prerequisites, need to show some documentation on how these credits can be achieved. There is a shift from version 4 to 4.10. We are not talking about the data. We want the data to speak itself about the performance of the building rather than we asking about the documentation. And that's what LEED version 4.1 ONN is all about. So this is the newest version of the rating system available for the operation and maintenance categories. The focus of LEED version 4.1 ONN is on the performance of the building rather than talking about the credits and prerequisites, right? Although there are few areas which cannot be measured through the performance area, that already is there with that. But 90% of the rating system is now tackled through the performance of the building. And we have the platform developed with us, which is called as the ARMS Guru. So ARMS Guru, what does it does? Basically, AskGuru is developed by UHGBC and GBC 2-3 years back. It's a performance-based assessment tool. It is available to all the projects now. So, ARC helps you assess the performance of the building on the various parameters. So, what are these parameters? So, there are five basic parameters: energy, water, waste, transportation, and human experience. To generate a performance score into each of this category, you require certain kind of data. So what are the data? You require 12 consecutive months of your energy consumption data. You require 12 consecutive months of water usage data. Waste analysis report. How much is your waste generated and how much is your waste diverted? Transportation survey. So we are doing a transportation survey to understand how your employees are commuting to your office or work. And lastly, an indoor environmental quality. There are two parts to it. One is an occupant satisfaction survey. It's a qualitative survey wherein we are asking user to feed the data about how they are feeling about the environment. So we have the online based, you know, survey ready with us. You just need to share the survey list with your employer and get the feedback from them. Second part of it, indoor air quality, which talks about your carbon dioxide and a TVOC evaluation. So you need to conduct a CO2 and TVOC testing in the different workspaces, and it should meet certain, you know, threshold which is provided under the LEED framework. So once you enter the data for the last 1 year, you will generate a score into the ARC platform. Now different points are given to different categories. For example, energy has the highest weightage, which is 33 points. Water gets you 15 points, waste gets you 8 points, transportation 14, and human experience 20. So the total points coming from the performance in these five categories are 90. The total scorecard is about 100. So 90 points completely coming from the performance of the building, how your building is performing. Rest 10 points are coming from few credits. So I was telling earlier, there are few credits that cannot be, you know, measured, like site-related credit, transportation-related credit, or maybe the policy-related credit, right? For which you need to provide certain documentation to approve the balance. So 90 plus 10, total 100 points. And based on this 100 points, a certification level will be decided. 40 plus will be certified, 50 plus will be silver, again 60 plus. So we have certified silver, gold, platinum. This level is there in the LEED certificate. So based on how much point you achieve, the, you know, the certification level will go up. So this is basically a snapshot of the platform which I've taken, wherein you can see the performance score of a sample building in all these categories. So we'll see the racetracks running in energy, water, waste, transportation. And in between the racetrack, you will see the total points. So they are achieving 81 points out of 100. Apart from showing the score of the building, this platform also does some data analytics job. Right? For example, under energy, you will be able to understand what is your carbon emission per square foot and per occupant. So that facility managers or owners will be able to track the data. And this is as light as you want, right? Suppose you feed the data now, the score will generate. And if you are connecting a facility with some BMS system and it's taking a, you know, the record maybe 15 seconds or 1 minute, then the score will vary based on your performance. So it's as light as you want. And then you can display the score in any of the areas to let your owners know, the occupants know, the visitor knows how your building is performing. To validate this, you need to go through the LEED certification process. So unlike if you apply for any other rating system, the process remains the same. You have to choose the right rating system for a project. You have to register your project under LEED Online, which is our platform to, you know, document and certify. Submit it for review to us with GBCI. GBCI will review and then you will, you know, award certification based on that. And then you can again go for a recertification program to the ARC platform, because this is again an ongoing, you know, process wherein we want projects to show their performance record and again recertify the project based on the data. Coming to statistics. Globally, there are around 3,400 registered projects alone in this category, industrial and warehousing category. Out of which, 2,150 projects are already certified. So if I talk about the numbers globally, it's huge. But if I talk about numbers in India, it's roughly around 108 projects we got into this, you know, industrial space. The total footprint available with us is 33 million square feet. The footprint, however, is comparatively large when you see the number of projects in India. However, the good news is that LEED, as many says, is, you know, available to particular kind of sectors. Like for garment, LEED is, you know, very popular. Like when I talk about the case of Bangladesh, we have 500 garment factories into the LEED certification program, right? But in India, we have, you know, participants from all the sectors. You will see a Colgate participating into LEED. You have SKF, which is heavy engineering. It produces, you know, ball bearings. So the reason I'm telling this, that LEED is applicable to diversified sector. It's all about, you know, interest and, you know, the commitment to achieving the LEED certification through process. So as I was telling, there are roughly around 451 projects alone in this Bangladesh region, which are heavily into the ready-made garment industries. Finally, I will touch upon one case study which is relevant to the garment and apparel industry. The case study is about Birla Century. This project is basically located at Gujarat, Bharuch. And this is a huge manufacturing plant which is spread across, you know, 104 acres with 40 odd buildings and structures into one campus. So all of these buildings are, you know, certified under the LEED program. This was the first manufacturing project in India and second in the world to achieve LEED V4 O&M rating system. So O&M is an existing building rating program. This factory was launched in the year 2008-2009, but it came to us in 2016-17 when it finally got, you know, certified under gold category. The reason of entering into the LEED certification program was many. Since Birla is a well-known name, they are already doing a lot of activities when it comes to, you know, achieving sustainability parameters in water, waste and energy. But since it was an old facility, they wanted to, you know, scale their bar when it comes to, you know, achieving higher performance. And they thought that LEED would be a better platform wherein they can showcase their performance, and also LEED will help us guide them to achieve higher energy efficiency, higher water efficiency. So in energy, they have achieved 17% better than the baseline case. So what is baseline basically in LEED is the ASHRAE baseline. So you know, ASHRAE is already as stringent in the market as well. And achieving a 70% over the baseline is again a humongous effort. I will tell you an example that initially when the project got developed, there were no provision of fresh air in the entire facility. And LEED has a prerequisite for having a minimum fresh air requirement in the entire facility. So then through the intervention of civil department and the design department, they have installed fresh air system into the entire process facilities and to the entire occupancy. Secondly, as I was mentioning, Birla Century is under the PAC consumer program. So they again need to show some energy efficiency benchmark when it comes to BE program. So through LEED, they have been able to successfully achieve 17%, which is well ahead than what the PAC program demands for. So this project is located in Gujarat, Bharuch. The total built-up area is roughly around 13 lakh. 47,000 square feet spread over 104 acres, out of which more than 50 acres is under the green areas and the open space areas. When it comes to the HVAC systems, the high side chillers, so they are using high efficiency VAM chillers in their process areas, because their building primarily consists of spinning areas, weaving areas, as your building consists of, right? So as the spaces are huge, they are using this high efficiency big chillers to serve those requirements. For the office areas, they are using again split AC, faster split AC than that. When it comes to introducing fresh air into the office space and the factory space, they are using evaporative cooling systems to meet the outdoor air requirement. And when it comes to your office space, they are using some fresh air in line fans too, Because fresh air is a very important part of a LEED rating program. If you are not involving fresh air into your space, you are not able to certify a project. So this is the minimum requirement that any project must consider while going for a LEED certification. from the process perspective, definitely they have done well in terms of, you know, having methods like heat recovery on boilers or using thermopack chillers, which are again high efficiency chillers available in the market. Also, they are using briquette, which is a waste product, as a fuel to, you know, drive the boiler instead of your natural gas or high speed diesel. So all this, you know, lead to their energy efficiency of 17% alone in that category. And rest, location and transportation, 15 out of 15, because they had all the shuttle services and other facilities available in the vicinity that accommodate. Sustainable side, because they have, you know, huge amount of open space and landscaping available to meet that. Water efficiency, again, is a, you know, big subject when it comes to manufacturing. You can do a lot when it comes to water, whether it's recycling of your, you know, water for flushing, for gardening and other purposes. Energy is very crucial subject, and given a higher weightage in a LEED rating program, because LEED has its own system goals that talks about climate change and global warming. So maximum points is allocated, you know, to energy. And from an industrial point of view, it's very critical and complex subject to, you know, to meet the energy efficiency. So LEED has those inbuilt tools and resources available that can help you achieve your efficiency. Materials again is another big subject, what kind of materials are used. We are also talking now about environmental product declaration certificates for a material. So the certificate itself calls about how your materials are designed, what is the life cycle analysis of those materials, so everything is covered. Environment, indoor environment quality, which talks about your fresh air, daylight views and other thermal comfort, that is again. Innovation talks about what additional you have done in terms of achieving the original priority. So all this basically comes to, you know, 110 points and what you are achieving. So they are achieving somewhere 70, which is under the gold category. So this is one of the, you know, widespread example in the garment industry which India has. There are many other companies. I believe in Tiruppur we have a couple of manufacturing facilities which have already, two of the manufacturing facilities, one is SAG and Knit Gallery. So they have already achieved LEED certification, and I believe some other companies also might be doing some certification in that. So we have proven examples, and you know, if you have any project, if you want to evaluate your, you know, factory from a LEED perspective, I can be reachable on my, you know, email, or I can share my contact details with you. You can feel free to call me and understand what are the further rating requirements when it comes to your facility. So thank you. I would like to again thank Mohan and CES for giving me an opportunity to present on how LEED works and what we can do better for you. Thank you for that.
LEED வந்து திருப்பூருக்கு புதுசு தான், பட் ஆல்மோஸ்ட் பங்களாதேஷில் வந்து 100+ ஃபேக்ட்ரிஸ் வந்து பண்ணியிருக்கிறாங்க. பையஸ் இப்போ கேட்க ஆரம்பிச்சிருக்காங்க ஒரு சில பையஸ். ஸோ இன்கேஸ் உங்களுக்கு ஏதாவது டவுட் இருந்துச்சுன்னா நீங்கள் கேட்கலாம். இதில் அர்லி ஸ்டேஜாக இருக்குன்னு வச்சிங்கன்னா ஸ்டில் ரைட் அண்ட் மெயில் டு டி ஆஃபீஸ், எனி டைம் வி கேன் ஹெல்ப் யூ. மிஸ்டர் சுரேஷ் இஸ் ஃப்ரம் சென்னை, யூ கேன் ஸ்பீக் தமிழ், ஸோ யூ வில் பி ஏபிள் டு ஹெல்ப் யூ. ஸோ லீடு வந்து ஜென்ரலாக வந்து புதுசாக ஒரு பில்டிங் கட்டும் பொழுது அங்கேருந்து ஆரம்பித்தோம்னா பெட்டராக இருக்கும். ஏற்கனவே இருக்கிற பில்டிங்கில் இருக்குதுன்னு சொன்னாக்க அது தனி கான்செப்ட்ஸ் இருக்குது. இதுதான் அவங்களோட பேசிக் கான்செப்ட்ஸ். ரேட்டிங் சிஸ்டம் வச்சு என்வரான்மெண்டல் ரேங்கில் பண்ணுறாங்க. ஸோ அடுத்த செஷன் போகிறதுக்கு முன்னாடி இந்த செஷனில் ஏதாவது டவுட்ஸ் தான் கேட்கலாம். நீங்கள்
என்ன மாதிரியான விஷயங்கள் செய்கிறாங்க
சார்? உங்கள் பில்டிங் வந்து இண்டிவிஜுவல் சைட்ஸை வந்து அசஸ் பண்ணிட்டேங்க சார். உங்களுக்கு அதில் என்னென்ன மாதிரி சேஞ்சஸ் கொண்டு வரலாம், எனர்ஜி ஆங்கில் என்ன கொண்டு வரலாம், வாட்டரில் என்ன கொண்டு வரலாம், ஃபியூவல் என்ன மாதிரி சேஞ்சஸ் கொண்டு வரலாம் அப்படிங்கிற கான்செப்ட்ஸை வந்து தே வில் கிவ் யூ. எனர்ஜி ஆடிட் பண்ணுற மாதிரி தான் பண்ணுவாங்க கெட்டலரில் வந்து. இதுக்கு வந்து இண்டிவிஜுவல் என்வரான்மெண்டல் ஆஸ்பெக்ட் எடுத்து ஸ்டடி பண்ணிவிட்டு அதுக்கான கேப்ஸை உங்களுக்கு சொல்லுவாங்க. உங்களுக்கு அந்த கேப்ஸ் மூலயமா உங்களுக்கு என்ன பெனிஃபிட் இருக்குங்கிறத காமிப்பாங்க. இதெல்லாம்
ஆல்ரெடி நம்ம வந்து அதை அட்ரஸ் பண்ணி ரிசல்ட்டி அப்புறம் எனர்ஜி சேவிங் இந்த மாதிரி எனர்ஜி ஆடிட்டும் பிக் இண்டெக்ஸ்லாம் பண்ணிட்டுருக்கோம். இதில் என்ன ஸ்பெஷல்
எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ்
சார் ஒரு விஷயம் சார், இப்போ ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் ஒரு சின்ன ஒரு கேஸ் சொல்ல பாருங்க, இவங்க சொன்னாங்க ஃப்ரெஷ் ஏர் சொல்றாங்க, விஓசிங்கிறாங்க, இதெல்லாம் நம்ம ஒன்றும் நான் கீழ்படுறது அட்லீஸ்ட் நம்ம அது சார். ரெண்டாவது வந்து வாட் இஸ் த ஆக்சிஜன் லெவல், ஃப்ரெஷ் ஏர் லெவல் வித்இன் த ஃபேக்டரி? அந்த ஸ்டடிஸ் வந்து ரெகுலரா பண்றோமா, எல்லா இடத்துலயும் இருக்குதா? சோ இந்த மாதிரி ஸ்டடிஸ் இது வந்து ஒன் ஆஃப் த ஃபேக்டர் தான், மல்டிபிள் ஃபேக்டர், இது ஒன் ஆஃப் த ஃபேக்டர் தான்.
உங்களுக்கு
ஒவ்வொரு கம்பெனிக்கும் வந்து இவங்க என்ன பண்ணியிருக்காங்கன்னா, ஸ்கோப் த்ரீ ஸ்பெசிஃபிக்காக போட்டுட்டு, இப்போ நம்ம கம்பெனியில் திருப்பூரில் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா முக்காசு பேர் பைக்கில் தான் வருவாங்க, பைக்கில் தான் வருவாங்க. ஒன்று நீங்கள் காமன் வெஹிக்கிள் தரலாம், ஸோ இண்டிவிஜுவல் பைக்ஸ் பப்ளிக் ட்ரான்ஸ்போர்ட் சிஸ்டம்ஸ், இல்லைன்னா கம்பெனியோட வெஹிக்கிள் சிஸ்டம் கொடுத்தீங்கன்னா இண்டிவிஜுவல் பைக்ஸ் வராது, இண்டிவிஜுவல் பெட்ரோல் கன்சூம் ஆகாது, இது ஒரு கான்செப்ட்டு. இன்னும் வந்து அப்ராட்லாம் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா வேறு ப்ரொமோட்டிங் சைக்கிள்ஸ், இப்போ நம்ம கண்ட்ரியில் கிடையாது, பட் நீங்கள் யூரோப்லாம் போனீங்கன்னா சைக்கிள்ஸ் வச்சுருக்காங்க, இப்போ சைக்கிள் ஸ்டாண்ட் வச்சுருக்கீங்களா, அந்த ப்ரொவிஷன் இருக்குதா உங்களுக்கு? ஸோ அந்த மாதிரி ப்ரொமோட் பண்ணுறாங்க. இது வந்து ஒன் ஆஃப் த என்வரான்மெண்ட் ஒரு இனிஷியேட்டிவ் தான்.
தேங்க்யூ.
ஸோ சர்டிஃபிகேஷன் ஃபீஸ் வந்து பர் ஸ்கொயர் ஃபீட் சார்ஜ் பண்ணுறாங்க, இந்த சார்ஜிங் பர் ஸ்கொயர் ஃபீட்டு.
என்ன
மாதிரியான டோட்டலாக ரெண்டு டிஃப்ரெண்ட் கான்செப்டே வேறு. இது வந்து பியூர்லி கஸ்டமர் ரெக்குவயர்மெண்ட் தான் பண்ணுறது. நிச்சயமாக ஜிபிசி சிஐஏலையும் பெனிஃபிட் இருக்குது, லீட்லையும் பெனிஃபிட் இருக்கும். எண்ட் ஆஃப் த டே ஒன் மோர் திங் இஸ் கஸ்டமர் ரெக்குவயர்மெண்ட். இப்போ சொல்கிற மாதிரி பங்களாதேஷில் எல்லாருமே வந்து போகிறதுனால கஸ்டமர் ஸ்டே கரெக்டாக நீங்கள் லீட் போயிருக்கீங்களா, நம்ம ப்ரொமோட் பண்ணால் கூட ஸ்டில் தேர் இன்சிஸ்டிங் ஆன் லீட், அவ்வளோதான். பட் வி கேன் கம்பேர் ஃப்ரம் ஒன் ஸ்டாண்டர்ட் டு அதர் ஸ்டாண்டர்ட் ஃபார் ஷுர். So you can still write up your questions. We are happy to help you out in giving the answers. We would like to go for session 2. Session 2 will be handled by Ramya Kandiyur. Ramya Kandiyur is BSc BTech from UICT from Mumbai. She is specialist in textile chemistry. She has almost more than 15-16 years of experience where she has worked in BSF and Thai Star, such companies. She is based out of Kochi. And she is expert in implementation of chemical management systems. So now we will have a topic on GHG, global greenhouse gas emissions. So can I invite Ramya to give her paper on that?
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Mohan, the TE Association, for giving us this opportunity here. And I'm going to be speaking on sustainability, about an aspect of sustainability which is very important, because climate change is one factor which is gaining importance in today's world. You would see that very shortly we would be having another session in Madrid, where a lot of people would be sitting out and discussing what are the policies that can be framed in order to bring in the necessary changes. The greenhouse gases are in across the world, across the sectors are increasing, and the climate change aspect is being seen in every single country. We would see it in terms of the rise in sea levels, the weather changes that are affecting us, etc. So in this presentation, we would be touching more on the aspects of the fashion supply chain, because a lot of study has been done. There are many sectors which are very relevant for the greenhouse gases, and fashion is one of them, because it is one industry which causes a lot of pollution in the world. Coming to the contents of the presentation, this is the main details which we would be talking about. We would be talking about the introduction of greenhouse gases, what is the global climate action scenario with respect to the fashion industry, what's the need for greenhouse gas quantification, a glossary of terms, because it is important that when we start to deal with the greenhouse gases, we understand this terminology. What is the calculation, quantification and calculation methodology? And what are the major retailers, what are they doing about the greenhouse gases? How are they trying to reduce it? What are the kind of targets that they are setting? And most importantly, when they are setting a target, what is its implication for a garment manufacturer? And finally, how can we help? So coming to the main causes of greenhouse gases, you can see that there is a lot of anthropogenic climate change which is happening in the country, in the globe, world over. And why is this happening? Because there is a lot of carbon dioxide emissions which are coming and which are apparently causing the energy waves to actually radiate more into the atmosphere rather than allow it to escape. So this is what is causing the actual greenhouse gas effect, or the global warming per se. There are 7 gases which have been actually identified as greenhouse gases. Most of it is in the form of carbon dioxide emissions, and you would see that with these carbon dioxide emissions, along with the other gases, this causes greenhouse gas and the warming which is there in experience throughout the world. So if you look at the global climate action scenario, you have organizations which have formed this fashion charter for climate change. A number of retailers, all those listed in the second paragraph here, have come together and decided on a charter on what is it that they would be in a position to do in order to combat climate change. So this is what is happening in the world, and this is something again which would be discussed in the Madrid session that would be happening from December 2nd onwards. If we look at the apparel value chain, this is a representative depiction of the apparel and footwear value chain. I'll be very happy to send this presentation across to those who would be interested. So you can just give me your email ID and I can send it across to you. So you wouldn't need to take pictures. So here we have the different tiers that are there. It is with respect to an retailer that this particular value chain has been created. It is from WRI. And here we say tier 0 as the actual office and the retail distribution sites of the retailer. So it could be perhaps a Marks & Spencer or a CNA or a Levi's office. So you have the office, retail and distribution center, which is tier 0. You have tier 1, which is the finished production assembly. You have tier 2, which is the material production. You have tier 3, which is the raw material processing. And you have tier 4, which is the raw material extraction. And finally, on the other side, you have your consumer use and you have the end of life. So this is your entire apparel value chain. and you have logistics which run right through it. So when we look at this value chain, you realize that in order to produce one single garment, there are so many different steps that are there before or through which the garment has actually got to go through. So when we are purchasing a garment, we might not understand the entire environmental aspect of it, but it has to go through all this entire value chain in order to come to us. And even after it comes to us, it goes through the process of the garment washing, the entire consumer use phase, and of course the end of life phase. So in this value chain, when you are trying to assess what are the greenhouse gases which can be associated with it, it is a rather complex process. So here it is depicted as to what are the greenhouse gases which are possible with this different value chain approach when we are looking at it. So you have your direct emissions, which are the scope 1 emissions. The gases that are mentioned on the top are the 7 greenhouse gases that are there, which are actually monitored. So the scope 1 are the direct emissions. It's very easy to control the scope 1 or the direct emissions. Now we have many IT companies which come into the picture which say that they are going carbon neutral. Now when we do not consider scope 3 at all, when they are not considering the hardware of the computers, etc., it is very easy to go carbon neutral. But when you consider your scope 3, when you consider all the aspects that are required for a particular manufacturer or for a particular service, it is actually a very complex process that through which you have to go through to become carbon neutral. So in this depiction, you have your scope 1, which is your direct, which is there in the middle. You have your scope 2, which is your indirect, which is your energy indirect, which could be any of the energy which you are actually purchasing for your processes. You have your scope 3 indirect, which is much more complex. So you, in your scope 3 indirect, you have all your purchased goods and services, you have your transportation, you have all the flights which are taken by the employees, etc. You have all the buildings, the outsourcing which is done by the organization. And this is the upstream scope 3. You also have your downstream scope 3. Now your downstream scope 3 will again have a lot of components into it in order to understand and estimate how will you capture all this information. It is actually a capture of the data of all the emissions that are possible because of the fact that you are involved in a manufacturing activity. If there are any questions, I'd be really happy to answer them, so we can clear it as and when they arise. Are there anything that you would like to
what is the indirect scope 2? Huh?
Question is, once again?
Scope 2 indirect.
Yes.
Yeah, scope 2 indirect is basically anything, for example, purchased electricity for a organization. You would be doing a lot of coal generation, and that would go into your direct scope 1 emissions. Scope 2, it will be anything that is purchased. We will come into a little more detail in the later slides on scope 1, 2 and 3. This is just an introduction, so we will go more into the detail about it. Anything else on these slides that you would like to clarify? So coming to the basic gases which are there, there are a number of gases. There are 7 main gases which have been classified as the greenhouse gases as per the standard. And why have they been classified? Because like we saw in our very first slide, it is these gases which actually go into the atmosphere and trap the energy in turn increases the energy within the atmosphere. So that is why these gases have been classified. And each of these gases have a different global warming potential. So again, we will come to that later. Coming to each of them, carbon dioxide is the main one which is monitored, and most of the emissions you will see with whatever you are manufacturing will generally come from carbon dioxide itself. So any process involving combustion of fossil fuels, manufacture of cement, lime, glass, etc. will lead to the release of carbon dioxide. Methane is another gas which is also potent. The production of chemicals, methanol, ethylene, ethylene oxides, manufacture of pulp and paper, all this would lead to the emission of methane. Then we have the production of nitric acid and caprolactam, etc., which would lead to N2O releases into the atmosphere. And NF3 is a relatively new gas which has come in, because initially when they defined the greenhouse gases, it was only the six gases which were defined, and NF3 is the newest entrant into the greenhouse gases. And this was found in, because we were creating a lot of solar panels, and solar panels have these LCD panels which require the use of certain chemicals which lead to the release of NF3. So that is how NF3 came into the picture. Then we have SF6, which basically is released with manufacture of magnesium, equipment of transmission and distribution of electricity. PFCs, in our industry, of course, it is common, because we are involved a lot with moisture management, prevention of different types of finishes on the garments. HFCs, these are again with the production of fluorochemicals, refrigeration and cooling equipment, foams and aerosols, etc. So these are the typical emissions, and these are the seven main gases which are considered. And when it comes to the GHG inventory, we go with a standard. So there are two main standards that we use. One is the GHG protocol, which is being developed by WPCSD and WRI together. And the other is the ISO 14064. Both these standards are relevant and are of use in the industry. It is we cannot compare both of them. Both of them are completely true in whatever they are saying and giving the information that they are giving. GHG protocol is a little more detailed. You have a lot of information in that, whereas the ISO is a little more clear cut on what needs to be done and how it needs to be done. And there are very minor changes in terms of scope. 1, 2, 3 is basically depicted in your GHG protocol, whereas ISO basically talks about it as direct emissions, indirect emissions, energy indirect, and other indirect. So these are very small minor changes that are there in between GHG and ISO, but the moment you start to follow one of them, you can continue to do that and you will still be correct in giving your quantifications. Coming to a bit of glossary of terms, because it's important that we understand this glossary when we are talking about greenhouse gases. One is greenhouse gas sink. It is a process which removes GHG from the atmosphere. So a greenhouse gas sink could be maybe a forest that you have created. It could be a green cover that you have generated in the organization. So this is an important factor when it comes to understanding and calculating the greenhouse gases. So greenhouse gas emission or removal factor, it is a factor relating activity data to GHG emissions or removal of the greenhouse gas. Activity data, this is one of the most common things that we start to calculate, because for any kind of activity, any kind of manufacture that we do will actually create this greenhouse gas. So this is your activity data. So it's a quantitative measure of the activity that that results in a greenhouse gas emission. And global warming potential, it's the index that used to translate the level of emissions of various gases into a common measure in order to compare the relative radiator force of different gases without directly calculating the changes in atmospheric concentration. So, like I said, each gas that is released will not have the same factor. So here you have, you can see here, what is it that each of this means. Like for example, if there is 1 ton of carbon dioxide which is released, you can see that when there is 1 ton of methane that is released, the global warming potential is 28 times that of 1 ton of carbon dioxide. So in a similar manner, when N2O is released, it is 265 times more potent than this 1 ton of carbon dioxide which is released. And you can see the factors again for the HFCs, the PFCs, and sulfur hexafluoride and nitrogen trifluoride. And this brings into perspective what is the actual damage that it is causing to the environment when something like this is released. For example, we say that solar panels are a very good option, but it would be a good option when the government is considering enough of recycling of these solar panels, because end of life of a solar panel is not always considered. We always talk about it only in the use phase, but not the end of life phase. Maybe when the next presentation is being made, you will understand a lot more on the life cycle when we talk also about the end of life phase. So these are things that we have to take into consideration. And in terms of global warming potential, this basically gives you the gravity of the situation when different gases are released. Coming to how do we take the inventory. In order to take the inventory, there are the first stage is basically establishing the organizational boundary. In order to do the organizational boundary, there are two types of approaches that are possible. One is the operational control approach, and one is the financial control approach, in the control approaches. And you could also have the equity share approach, that is how much does an like for each organization, you will have how are you controlling, what are the number of other subsidiary organizations that you have. So if you have subsidiary organizations, do you have full control over it, or is it only that you're controlling it partly? So it's based on these that you will have to start to calculate the inventory. So once you establish whether it is the control approach or the equity share approach that you would like to go with for your GHG inventory, in the control approach, you have to again decide whether it is just operational control or financial control that you have. So based on that, you can decide on how are you establishing your organizational boundary. A boundary is important because when we are trying to set in a standard, when we are trying to stick to a standard, it is always important to establish the boundaries based on which we will be doing our calculations and publishing our results. Whatever GHG inventory is done is going to stand us good for the next coming, n number of years. So we have to do this with great care to see that whatever we are doing is consistent. So after your first stage, the second stage is defining the operational boundary. So again, in the operational boundary, you could say it is this particular factory that I am going to consider. Let us say you have 10 different factories, you could say that it is this particular factory that I am going to consider. Or you could say that it is all the 10 factories that I would be considering. So this would be your operational boundary. So you consider first your organizational boundary, and then we go to the operational boundary. And this is again, in terms of data collection, we need to see what is it that we would be doing, whether we would be taking a cradle-to-gate approach, a gate-to-gate approach, or a cradle-to-grave approach for our calculations. So coming to the type of emissions, we have here the scope 1, the scope 2, and the scope 3. So in scope 1, these are your direct emissions, whatever result with the kind of activity that you do. So perhaps you would be having a boiler, you would be using maybe a fire extinguisher, you would have petrol in order to fuel certain things. So all that will come under your scope 1 emissions. This is the emissions that are coming out directly from the activity that you are doing, whatever is your manufacturing activity or your service activity. Those are your scope 1. Scope 2 are the indirect GHG emissions which affect from perhaps purchased fuel. And scope 3 would be the other indirect emissions which could result basically from your transportation, your logistics, your employees traveling from one place to the other. So all this would come under your scope 3. So how do we quantify, what is the type of information that we gather in order to quantify it? For your scope 1, it would be your, we could use, these are again examples that I have provided of what could be used for quantification. So your diesel and petrol, if you are perhaps using it in your operations, you can take purchase bills. Refrigeration, you can take your AMC information, how much of refrigerant have you actually refilled in a year. Whatever is your fire extinguisher top up, you could take it from your safety department. LPG gas, you could take what are the purchase bills that are there that can be considered. For example, again here is of acetylene, so you can use your purchase bills here again for scope 1. These are your direct emissions, scope 1. Scope 2 is your electricity purchased or your gas purchased. Again, you can use the bills that are there in order to quantify and give an evidence for your scope 2. And scope 3 is could be anything like business travel, material transport, employee commute. So all this would come under your scope 3 emissions. So it depends on how you would like to quantify it. The main thing is that we want to keep it in a repeatable manner. So whatever you're doing in one particular year should be repeatable when you're again trying to do your quantification in the following year. Are there anything that you would like to clarify?
Scope 1, scope 2, you are getting clarified actually. What is
scope 1? Scope 1,
the last point. That's just an example I have put in. So it's, let us say,
so some in some countries they use acetylene as one of their fuel. Maybe it is not applicable for India. Like natural gas, some people run their vehicles on gas, some people do on diesel. In boilers, if you see, some people use either EV or fuel, like crude oil or briquettes. So fuel will change. Some vehicle may run on methanol, for example. So those are the things. So you're using within your boundary, acetylene will come under scope 1. Before we go forward, TN39BE8492, shift vehicle. Yes, sir.
What is the number, please?
TN39BE8492, shift. Shift vehicle.
Coming to the calculation part of it, once we take all this information, we take the emission as the activity data into the emission factor. So this is done in order to understand, like you have these data banks which will give you emission factors for various components that you would be using. So based on that, you can do this calculation. So emission factor is a value that relates to the average quantity of the GHG released to the atmosphere with an activity associated with the release of the GHG. It's usually expressed in weight of GHG divided by a unit of activity emitting the GHG. For example, carbon dioxide emitted per megagram of coal burn, as an example. So in your scope 1 calculation, mostly it is from, it could be from, so 99% is from coal, but again it is plant specific. You you can have your NCB values for the whole and finally do the ultimate analysis. Your scope 2, in India, we use 234 gigawatts. So the India grid is basically 67% thermal and 13% renewable energy. In other countries, the distribution is different. So that's why it's specifically mentioned that this is the percentage. And you have the north grid and the southern grid with different quantities. So those are also mentioned. And in scope 3, basically you take the values again from the IPCC values. So whatever is your global petrol standard, for example, for all the business travel that has been done, or whatever is the fuel that you will be reimbursing to your employees, etc. And the weighted average of the samples worldwide is considered in for scope 3. And after we look at the quantification that is possible, we look at what are the major retailers, how are they targeting their reductions. So they are targeting their reduction based on certain science-based targets. Here I have taken some examples because it is important that we also take into light like what are the others doing and how are they doing it and what is its effect on us. For example, ASICS here is committing. There are three or four main things that we have to look at when a retailer is committing to a certain thing. One is what is the base year, what is the reduction in scope 1, what is the reduction in scope 2 and scope 3, and finally, by what year are they committing to do this reduction. So if just imagine an imaginary table that we are creating where we are talking about what is the base year. So ASICS has a base year of 2015. Their target year is 2030. They wish to reduce definitely, absolutely, the scope 1, scope 2 and scope 3. Scope 1 and 2 is by 33%, whereas scope 3 is by 55%. And when we go back to the slide where we talked about the value chain and how tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 are actually talking about the scope emissions, we would see that scope 3 emissions come a lot from purchased goods and services. Now for a retailer, like for example Marks & Spencer is buying a lot of stuff from different places. So that is creating a lot of scope 3 emissions. And that is a part that they want to quantify when they say that they will reduce the scope 3 emission. So reducing scope 3 by 55 means that the entire value chain, whoever are supplying to Marks & Spencer, are going to help them in reducing this by 55%. So that is where a manufacturer will actually come in. So that is the relevance when a retailer is setting a target, also for every single supplier who is supplying to the party. So you have H&M here who is committing to reduce the absolute targets again, scope 1 and 2 by 40%. The base year here is 2017 as against a target year of 2030. So this is the number of years that they are going to take to reduce it. And the scope 3 emissions are going to be reduced by 59% for H&M, which is a very high target, which is a very high score, and I'm sure they have their own reasons and workings as to how they would be achieving this. So Kering is another one. Here in Kering, we are basically talking about reducing scope 1, scope 2 and scope 3 from upstream, transportation and distribution, business air travel, fuel and energy related emissions, 50% per unit of value. So there are two different ways in which you can set your targets. Like ASICS and H&M have set it on absolute terms. Kering has set it on per unit of the value added by a particular year. So it is per unit of manufacture of a particular material, for example, or a product that they manufacture. So this is a different way in which you can set your target. Levi's again have committed to reduction in scope 1, scope 2 by 90% by 2025, which is a very heavy, stiff task, with a 2016 base year. So you have to take a base year and you have to set your target year, and you have to then decide on how much you're going to be reducing. So this is an absolute reduction that Levi's have come up with. And the scope 3 emissions are going to be reduced by 40% by 2025. So that's the target that they have set. And a few more retailers here. So this we have for Marks and Spencer, Target, Tesco and Walmart. Again, on a similar line, if you compare as to what is it that, what is the base here, what is the scope 1 emission that they will reduce, scope 2 emission that they will reduce, and what is the target year by which they will actually get this reduction. Marks and Spencer have again have got a very stiff target. They wish to do scope 1 and scope 2 by 80% and scope 3 by almost scope 3 here again is mentioned in the number of tons of carbon dioxide that they will be reducing between two different years, 2017 and 2030. So you have target which is then looking at scope 1, scope 2 and scope 3 reductions, 1 and 2 by 30%, and target is also committing to 80% of its supplier by spend covering all purchased goods and services with said science-based scope 1 and 2 targets by 2023. So this is the basically, in order to reduce your scope 3, you have to push out your target to also all your suppliers. And that is exactly what is happening in the market today, because when people are asking organization, do you have your GHG emissions, have you worked out? So what will happen is it will help the organization, or it will help the retailer to understand when partnering with a particular organization, how much of benefit is going to have, is it going to have for that particular retailer. So that is the calculation that they will do. And all the sustainability aspects, like for example, Ghg Lca, or for example, the GHG emission target, all this will finally lead to what is the value add that you will have for the retailer. So that is how they are going to actually look at it. So Tesco here is again committing to scope 1 and scope 2 reductions, 60% by 2025 using a 2015 base year. Scope 3 reduction by 17%. So a scope 3 reduction target is more relevant for a manufacturer when we are looking at the retailer targets, because that indicates how much are they going to push the supply chain to giving the values that they actually want, because that is the only way they are going to achieve their own targets. And Walmart has actually come up with this gigaton, 1 billion gigaton of carbon dioxide to be removed from all their supply chain. You would be aware Walmart has a huge supply chain, and when they're committing to something like this, the entire supply chain is actually taking the responsibility of reducing their own greenhouse gas emissions with the productivity. So this is of course not just for apparel, this includes everything that Walmart sells. But the Gigaton project by Walmart is a very prestigious project that they have taken up. So here we have, I've taken two examples, one of Levi's and another of CNA, of how the GHG emissions for an apparel or a retailer looks like, because it is very interesting to understand how it actually measures out. So you have Levi's, which has published in 2018 what is the GHG emissions. So a part of it, that is about 31%, comes out from fabric production. Cotton cultivation is about 10%. Consumer use is about 34%. Of course, consumer use would definitely be a big piece in the garment industry, as we would all know. But that apart, you have also the other stages. So it is different for different retailers. Each retailer takes their own measure as to how much of greenhouse gases are being emitted because of whatever are the factors that they are doing. So here you could see that fabric production for Levi's is a huge share after carbon, after consumer use. If you look at the example from CNA, most of it is scope 3 for CNA. Scope 1 is very minimal because of the type of emissions that we are actually reporting. Scope 2 is about 4.1%. Scope 3 is almost 95.86. And of this 95.86, if we see, what is it that that are actually taken into scope 3? It's the waste generated, it's the business travel related, whatever other fuels. So each different distributor or each different retailer will give out their calculations based on whatever are their particular activities. So it will not be uniform for everyone, it will differ for every single party. And as a summary, we have seen what is causing the greenhouse gases, how it can be controlled, what are the kind of targets we are taking, but what are the different ways in which the apparel industry can actually reduce the emissions. So there are two different things which are being suggested by WRI. This is directly from one of their reports. So one is to aggressively deploy energy efficiency and renewable energy across the value chain. This is one factor which will help the apparel industry to reduce the greenhouse gases. And substitute materials with lower environmental impact. So if we know, for example, there is organic cotton and there is polyester. So polyester is completely being taken up or being manufactured with the use of fossil fuels, whereas organic cotton is taking up much less of carbon emissions, etc. Its carbon footprint is much lower. So when you're using something with much lower carbon footprint, your emissions will also be automatically curbed. So that is why the MSI is very important, because we are looking at what is the sustainability index of a particular fiber or material of which the fabric is made. And these are the key elements. So in tier 1 and tier 2, tier 3 and tier 4, what are the different aspects that can be considered is what we are looking at in terms of GHG emissions reductions. And a little more on my organization. I run a consultancy service called Reach for Green Solutions. And there are three main aspects in which I provide help. One is product endorsement. I endorse an antimicrobial called Silver Dawn for the industry. It's a DuPont product. Secondly, we provide sustainability services. We help with management system implementations. We help with product safety enhancement, Higg index verifications, etc. And of course, we conduct a lot of trainings and workshops for the industry, mainly on chemical management, on sustainability aspects, Higg index implementations, achieving a better score. So these are some of the sustainability services that we offer. And this is my contact details. And I'll be very happy to send you the presentation. You can just give me a card and I can send the presentation to you.
Okay. Such a dry subject. Environmenting mode. LCS, further more dry subject. இப்போ ஃபர்ஸ்ட் பேசுனது லீட் பேசணும், என்வரன்மெண்ட் எனர்ஜி பேசணும், அடுத்தது வந்து ஜிஹெச் எமிஷன்ஸ் பேசணும். எல்சிஏங்கிறது என்னன்னு கேட்டீங்கன்னா, எந்த ஒரு ப்ராடக்ட்டுக்கும் பெருப்புலேருந்து இறப்பு குறையும், என்னென்ன ரிசோர்ஸஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், எந்த ஸ்டேஜில் எது அதிகமாக யூஸ் ஆகுது, எங்கே கான்சென்ட் பண்ணால் எப்படி பண்ணலாங்கிற பண்ணுற ஸ்டடி தான் வந்து எல்சி. ஸோ எல்சிஐக்கு வந்து யூகன் கால் இட் அஸ் லைஃப் சைக்கிள் அனாலிசிஸ் ஆர் யூ கேன் கால் இட் அஸ் அ லைஃப் சைக்கிள் அசஸ்மெண்ட் அப்படின்னு சொல்லலாம். நம்ம டிஷர்ட் எடுத்துட்டீங்கன்னா காட்டன் கல்டிவேஷன்லேருந்து எங் யூஸர் தூக்கி போடுற வரையும் அதில் வந்து என்னென்ன ஆக்டிவிட்டி நடக்குது, என்ன பண்ணுறோம், ஹவு கேன் வி ஹெல்ப் என்வரான்மெண்ட் படிக்கிறதா வந்து எல்சி. ஸோ இது ஒரு கேஸ் ஸ்டடியாகவே காமிச்சிருக்கேன். இஃப் எஃபர்ட் ஆல் யூஆர் சோர்சிங் காட்டன் ஃப்ரம் குஜராத், குஜராத்தில் காட்டன் வாங்குறீங்க, இட் இஸ் கம்மிங் டு திருப்பூர் எய்தர் பை லாரி ஆர் இட்ஸ் கம்மிங் பை ஷிப் டு கொச்சின், ஃப்ரம் ஷிப் டு கொச்சினுக்கு வருது அப்படின்னா அதில் எவ்வளோ வந்து ஆர்கானிக் காட்டன் வாங்குகிறோம். அப்போ ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் நம்ம காட்டன் வாங்குறோம்னா காட்டன் ஃபார்மில் வந்து 100 கிலோ காட்டன் உற்பத்தி ஆகிடுச்சுன்னு சொன்னாக்கா 35 கிலோ தான் பஞ்சாப், பாக்கி 65 கிலோ வேஸ்ட். 100 கிலோ ஃபார்மில் இருந்து பஞ்சு எடுத்தாங்கன்னா பருத்தி கொட்டை எல்லாம் சேர்ந்து 65%, 30% 35% தான் வந்து பஞ்சு. ஸோ நமக்கு வந்து ஒரு நாளைக்கு 10,000 கிலோ யூஸ் பண்ணுறீங்கன்னா அது வந்து 35% தான், பாக்கி வந்து ஃபுல் அண்ட் ஃபுல் எங்கே வேஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஆயிருக்கு, ஜின்னிங்கில் வேஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஆயிருக்குன்னு அர்த்தம். ஸோ இந்த ஸ்டடியெல்லாம் வந்து எல்சியில் வரும். அதே போல் கமர்ஷியல் காட்டன் நம்மள்கிட்ட வந்து 10,000 கிலோ விடலாம், 100 கிலோ விடாந்துச்சுன்னா நூலாக மாறுறது வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ஒரு 72-75% நூலாக மாறும், பாக்கி எல்லாம் ஷார்ட் ஃபைபர்ஸ்லையும் வேஸ்ட்லேயும் போயிடும். ஸோ ஒரு ஆவரேஜ் வெயிட் ஆஃப் கார்மெண்ட் 150 கிராம் 140 கிராம் ஒரு டிஷர்ட் எடுத்துட்டோம்னா அதோட லைஃப் ஸ்டைல் எப்படி இருக்குன்னு பார்க்க தான் வந்து பார்க்குறோம் நம்ம. ஸோ ஜென்ரலாக கேட் எஃபிஷியன்சி 82%, இது தெரியும் உங்களுக்கு. ஸோ ஒரு நாளைக்கு வந்து ஒரு 10,000 கிலோ ஸ்பெண்டிங் பண்ணுறோம், அதன் மூலயமா 140 கிராம் மெனி 84,000 கிராம் பண்ணுறோம்னு சொன்னால் ஒரு நாளைக்கு அந்த கார்மெண்ட்ஸ் ட்ராவல் டைமில் எவ்வளோ தண்ணி யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், எவ்வளோ கெமிக்கல்ஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், எவ்வளோ எனர்ஜி யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், எவ்வளோ கார்பன் லிமிட் ஆகுது, அதுக்கான ஸ்டடி தான் இருக்குது. ஸோ ஃபார்மன் ஃபார்ம் காட்டன் வந்து 39,000 கிலோ எடுத்தால் தான் நமக்கு ஜின்னிங் பண்ணி 13,650 கிலோ வரும், 13,650 சொன்னீங்கன்னா ஸ்பின்னிங்கில் வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 10,000 கிலோ ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணலாம், நிட்டிங்கில் வந்து 10,000 கிலோ, டையிங்கில் 10,000 கிலோ, ஃபேப்ரிக்காக போகும்போது 80% லாஸு. ஸோ 9,000 கிலோ ஆவரேஜாக போகும். அதே வந்து ஃபேப்ரிக் வந்து கட் பண்ணும்போது கேட் எஃபிஷியன்ஸ் 82%, 7,500 கிலோ 7,500 கிலோ தான் வந்து கார்மெண்ட்ஸாக மாறும். ஸோ அதை ஸ்டிச் பண்ணி ஒரு 60% வந்து பிரிண்ட் ஆகுது, மணல் பிரிண்ட் ஆகுது, பேக் பண்ணி அனுப்புகிறோம். ஸோ கண்டெய்னர் வெயிட் சேர்த்து நம்ம அங்கேருந்து அனுப்பும் போது 11 டன்ஸ் இங்கேருந்து வெளியில் போகுது யூரோப்பு. ஸோ அணுகிரக பொறுத்தவரை எங்கள் கம்பெனியை பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங்கில் வந்து ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் நெட்டிங் ஹேஸ் காட் மோர் தான் 94% க்ரீன் எனர்ஜி, எங்கள் ஸ்டடியில் இது எடுத்திருக்கோம். ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் நெட்டிங் ஹேஸ் காட் 60% ஒர்க் பர்சன்ட் டார்மெட்ரி, டையிங் எனர்ஜி கன்சம்ஷன் ஹேஸ் காட் 70% க்ரீன் எனர்ஜி, dyeing uses coal as one of the major electricity fuel, garmenting uses energy consumption has got 60% green energy, garment units has 45% work force in garmentry, less than 0.5% airship level. So in the basic ke naanga or life cycle analysis panirukom. Formula pathina major emissions enga varudna fertilizers and manures, உரத்தாலையும் பூச்சி மருந்தாலும் மெயின் எமிஷன்ஸே வருது, ப்ளஸ் லேண்ட் பொல்யூஷன். இது எப்படி அவாய்ட் பண்ணலாம்னு கேட்டிங்கன்னா ஆர்கானிக் காட்டனுக்கு மூவ் பண்ணிங்கன்னா இதை அவாய்ட் பண்ணலாம். ஸோ ஹவு ஆர் வி சேவிங் அவர் ஹெல்த், நம்ம உலகத்தை நம்ம எப்படி பாதுகாக்கலாம்னா கஸ்டமர்ஸோட ரெக்குவயர்மெண்ட்னாலையும் நம்மளோட ஆர்கானிக் காட்டன் மூவ்மெண்ட் மூவ் ஆனிச்சுன்னு சொன்னாக்கா வி கேன் சேவ் ஹெல்த் லேண்ட் பொல்யூஷன் ஆஸ் வெல் அஸ் எமிஷன்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் ஃபெர்டிலைசர்ஸ் அண்ட் மெனியூர்ஸ். ஸோ அதுக்கான ஸ்டடி. ஸோ இதில் வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா மேஜர் ஃபெர்டிலைசர்ஸ் தான், ஃபெர்டிலைசர்ஸ்க்கு அடுத்தபடியாக இருக்கிறது 21% எலக்ட்ரிசிட்டி. ஃபார்மில் என்ன எலக்ட்ரிசிட்டின்னு கேட்டிங்கன்னா இரிகேஷன் ஆஃப் வாட்டர் இருக்குது, மெயினாக வந்து ஃபியூலும் எனர்ஜியும் தேவைப்படுது. அதே போல் இது பாருங்க ஃபார்ம் ஃபயர், ரீசனாக பார்த்துருக்கேன் டெல்லியில் வந்து பஞ்சாபில் ஹரியானாலாம் வந்து வயலில் எரிக்கிறாங்க, அதனால தான் பொல்யூஷன் வருதுங்கிறாங்க இல்லையா. ஃபார்ம் ஃபயர் வந்து மேஜர் ஃபார்ம் எமிஷன். அதுக்கு அடுத்தபடியா நம்ம சப்ளை செயின்ல பார்க்க போனீங்கன்னா ஸ்பின்னிங் நிட்டிங் டையிங் பிரிண்டிங் கார்மெண்டிங்ல பார்க்க போனீங்கன்னா ரொம்ப அதிகமா எனர்ஜி யூஸ் பண்ணக்கூடிய செக்டர் எதுன்னு கேட்டீங்கன்னா ஸ்பின்னிங் கன்சியூம்ஸ் மோர் தன் 57 or 58% ஆஃப் பவர் வந்து எங்க யூஸ் ஆகுதுன்னா ஸ்பின்னிங்ல யூஸ் ஆகுது. அதுக்கு அடுத்த மேஜர் ஷேர் வந்து டையிங்ல இருக்கு. ஸோ ஸ்பின்னிங்கும் டையிங்கும் இஸ் த ஹாட் ஸ்பாட் ஃபார் எனர்ஜி ஆடிட். ஸோ ஸ்பின்னிங் தான் மேஜரு. எஸ் ப்ளீஸ்.
ஸ்பின்னிங்ல பாத்தீங்கன்னா கம்ப்ளீட்டா எலக்ட்ரிசிட்டி தான் அதிகமா யூஸ்
பண்ணுவாங்க. ஆமா.
ஆனா டையிங்ல அப்படி கிடையாது.
ஆமா.
டையிங்ல வந்து ஃபோசில் ஃபியூல் நிறைய யூஸ்
பண்ணுவாங்க. ஆமா.
ஸோ கார்பன் எமிஷன் நீங்க எடுத்துக்கிட்டீங்கன்னா நெட்டிங்கோட
இல்ல இல்ல புரியுது
டையிங் தான் ஜாஸ்தியா
இல்ல. இப்ப நம்ம லைஃப் ஸ்டான்ஸ் எல்லாம் தனித்தனியா பாக்குறோம். தண்ணி எங்க யூஸ் ஆகுது, எனர்ஜி எங்க, கார்பன் தனித்தனியா வரும், அது பார்க்கலாம், அதையும் பார்க்கலாம். ஸோ எனர்ஜியை பொறுத்தவரை இபியை பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங் ஜாஸ்தி, அடுத்தபடி டையிங் இருக்கு. ஸ்பின்னிங்குள்ளேயே வித்தின் ஸ்பின்னிங்குள்ளே ப்ளோரமா காடிங்கா எது மேஜர் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ஸ்ப்ரிங் ஸ்பின்னிங் ஜாஸ்தி, அடுத்தது ஆட்டோ பண்ணணும். ஸோ எதுக்குன்னா ஒன்று வந்து நம்ம சப்ளை செயின்ல இபி ஆங்கிள் எங்கே கன்சிடர் பண்ணணும், ஒன்று ஒன்று வந்து ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் டையிங். ஸோ அதே ஸ்பின்னிங்ல எங்கே பார்க்கணும்னா ஆட்டோ பண்ணர் அண்ட் ஸ்ப்ரிங் ஃப்ரண்ட். இது வந்து கிவ்ஸ் யூ ஒன் அவுட்லுக், எங்கே கன்சிடர் பண்ணணுங்கிற அவுட்லுக் கொடுத்தோம் அந்த எல்சி. So, I have said that Anugrah has got almost 85% of green energy. So, that's why we have and the scope to emissions is less. Now, coming back to water consumptions, one conventional unit is conventional unit is 93% of water is used. டையிங் இண்டஸ்ட்ரியல் ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் யூஸ் வந்து டையிங் வந்து அதிகம் 93%. ஸோ இம்ப்ளிமெண்ட் ஆஃப் ZLV இஸ் வெரி மச் ரெக்வயர்ட். ஸோ மற்ற கண்ட்ரீஸும் கம்பேர் பண்ணும்போது, மற்ற ஸ்டேட் கம்பேர் பண்ணும்போது வி ஆர் ஃபார் ஃபார் ஹெட். ஸோ வாட்டர் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா எங்களோட யூனிட்டை வந்து ஆல்மோஸ்ட் 6 லட்சம் லிட்டர் யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம். அதில் வந்து ஆல்மோஸ்ட் 6 லட்சம் லிட்டர்ஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம். அதில் வந்து 5 லட்சம் லிட்டர் தண்ணியை ரீயூஸ் பண்ணுறதுனால ஒரு 50 லிட்டர் 60 லிட்டர் தான் வெளியே இருந்து வாங்குறோம், முனிசிபல்லேருந்து வாங்குறோம். ஸோ ஒரு நாளைக்கு 5 லட்சம் லிட்டர் நம்ம தண்ணி யூஸ் சேவ் பண்ணுறோம். விச் மீன்ஸ் ஒரு டிஷர்ட்டுக்கு நம்ம 10 லிட்டர் தண்ணி சேவ் பண்ணுறோம். ஒரு நாளைக்கு 54 டிஷர்ட் பண்ணணும்னு சொல்லாங்க ஃபிகர்ஸ். ஸோ ஒரு அகமதாபாத்லேயோ கல்கத்தாலேயோ லூதியானாவில் ட்ரை பண்ணுறதுக்கும் நம்ம திருப்பூர் ட்ரை பண்ணுறதுக்கும் ஒரு டிஃப்ரென்ஸ் அங்கே தெரியும் உங்களுக்கு. இது டிஃப்ரென்ஸ். இது வாட்டர் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் டொமஸ்டிக். இண்டஸ்ட்ரி மட்டும் எடுக்கூடாது, டொமஸ்டிக் எடுக்கணும். ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் எங்களுக்கு டார்மெண்ட்ரி இருக்கு, ஹாஸ்டல் இருக்கு. நாங்கள் எவ்வளோ தண்ணி யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ரொம்ப அதிகமாக யூஸ் பண்ணுற இடம் வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா கார்மெண்டிங்கும் ஸ்பின்னிங் தான். ஏன்னு கேட்டிங்கன்னா ஹாஸ்டலில் இருக்கக்கூடிய லேடிஸ் ஜென்ஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணுற தண்ணியை தான் கணக்கு எடுத்துருக்கோம். என்ன சொல்ல போனாக்கா டையிங்கை விட அதிகமாக தண்ணி எங்கே யூஸ் ஆகுதுன்னா ஸ்பின்னிங் கார்பன் தான் யூஸ் ஆகுது எங்கள் கம்பெனியை பொறுத்தவரை. ஸோ உங்களுக்கு ஹாஸ்டல் இருந்துச்சுன்னா நீங்கள் ஸ்டடி பண்ணி பார்த்தீங்கன்னா உங்களுக்கு அதிகமாக அங்கே தான் இருக்கும். ஸோ ஜென்ரல் நினைச்சிட்டு இருக்காங்கன்னா டைமில் தான் தண்ணி அதிகமாக சொன்ன கிடையவே கிடையாது. எங்கள் இண்டஸ்ட்ரி பொறுத்தவரை நாங்கள் எங்களோட பவுண்ட்ரி பொறுத்தவரை கார்மெண்டிங் ஸ்பின்னிங் தான் ஜாஸ்தி. இது ஒரு ஸ்டடி, எல்சியில் ஒரு ஸ்டடி இருக்கு.
ஆக்சுவலாக தண்ணி அதிகமாக செலவு பண்ணுறாங்க, இங்கே வந்து வேஸ்ட் வாட்டராக மாறுறதுனால நம்ம இதை இதே மீன் பண்ணிக்கலாம்
சார். அதாவது வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் அவைலபிலிட்டி இன் தமிழ்நாடு இஸ் வெரி லெஸ். அது வந்து டாக் ஆஃப் த டாபிக் அப்படிங்கிற ஒரு சப்ஜெக்ட் எடுக்கும்பொழுது நிச்சயமாக டொமஸ்டிக் ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் கன்சப்ஷன் பார்த்தே ஆகணும். ஒரு நாளைக்கு ஒரு ஆளுக்கு நூத்தம்பது லிட்டர் ஆகுது ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் அது திருப்பி அதே ஆளுக்கு போக மாட்டேங்குது அது என்ன ஆகும்னா ட்ரீட் பண்ணி ஃபார்ம் பண்ண போகுமே தவிர திருப்பி ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் டெய்லி கன்சூம் அதிகமாக இருந்தது. ஸோ அதுக்கான ஸ்டடி தான். ஸோ அதுக்கு வந்து இந்த ரெயின் வாட்டர் ஹார்வெஸ்டிங் இதெல்லாம் தான் எங்கள் ஆக்ஷன் பிளான். நவ் கமிங் பேக் டு கார்பன் எமிஷன். கார்பன் எமிஷன் வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா டெய்லிங் வில் பி ஹையஸ்ட் பிகாஸ் ஆஃப் கோல் வேறு வழி கிடையாது. ஸோ கோல் வந்து மேஜராக பாய்லர் லேங்கில், மற்றபடி இபி வந்து ஆல்மோஸ்ட் 60% மேலே க்ரீன் எனர்ஜி இருக்கிறதுனால
எங்களுக்கு அந்த ஒரு கன்வென்ஷனல் யூனிட் ஒரு யூனிட்ல வந்து சோலார் இல்லாம விண்மீன் இல்லாம பண்ணிட்டாங்கன்னா இந்த டிஃபரன்ஸ் இருக்கும். ஸோ கன்வென்ஷனல் ஒரு யூனிட் வந்து 100% இபில ஓடுச்சுன்னா எங்க கம்பெனி வந்து 65% மேல கிரீன் எனர்ஜி யூஸ் பண்றதுக்கு இந்த டிஃபரன்ஸ் வருது. அது மட்டும் இல்லாம கோல் கன்சப்ஷன்ல வந்து நீங்க ப்ராப்பரா மானிட்டர் பண்ணி அதை மெக்கனைஸ் பண்ணி ப்ராப்பரா லோட் பண்ணீங்கன்னா கோல் கொஞ்சம் கம்மியாகும். கோல் கன்சப்ஷன் கம்மியானுச்சுன்னா உங்களோட கார்பன் எமிஷன் கம்மியாகும். ஸோ 50% ஆஃப் கார்பனேஷன் ஆஸ் கம்பேர்ட் டு கன்வென்ஷனல் போட்டிருப்பாங்க. சோஷியல் ரிஸ்க், சப்ளை செயின் கீழே போக போக சோஷியல் ரிஸ்க் ரேட்டிங் அதிகமாகும். ஸோ ரிட்டைலரில் கிரீன்ல ஆரம்பிச்சதுன்னா ஃபார்மிங் போகும்போது ரெட்ல வந்து நிற்கும். ஸோ ஸ்பின்னிங் வந்து சோஷியல் கம்ப்ளைன்ஸ் இஷ்யூஸ் ஜாஸ்தியாகும், போக போக கம்மியாகும். ஸோ நம்ம வந்து எல்சிஏ படிக்கும் பொழுது நாட் ஒன்லி என்வரான்மெண்டல், ஹியூமன் இம்பாக்ட், ஹெல்த் அண்ட் சேஃப்டி எல்லாமே ஃப்ரீ பண்ணுறோம். ஸோ அதுக்கான ஸ்டடி, ஸோ மேன் பவர் ஸ்டடி பார்க்கும்போது major manpower where we are using is garmenting. So more than 62% of manpower we are utilizing is in garmenting industry. So another guy has got almost 60-38 as the women and men ratio. So this gives you overall picture. For a T-shirt பண்றதுக்கு எவ்வளோ domestic water வேணும், எவ்வளோ industrial water வேணும், எவ்வளோ chemicals வேணும், ஹசரஸ் வேஸ்ட் எவ்வளோ வெளியே வருது, CO2 எவ்வளோ வெளியே வருது, கோல் எவ்வளோ யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், க்ரீன் எனர்ஜி எவ்வளோ யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், கிரிட் எனர்ஜி எவ்வளோ யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம், எவ்வளோ எவ்வளோ வெளியே இருக்கிறோம். ஸோ இதோட ஃபுல் ஸ்டடி, த ஃபுல் ஸ்டடி கிவ்ஸ் யூ த எல்சி அப்ரோச். ஸோ இது பண்ணி வச்சுக்கிறது பெட்டர், நான் கஸ்டமர்ஸ் கேட்குறாங்க இல்லையோ நமக்கு தெரியும். ஸோ இண்டஸ்ட்ரியல் வாட்டரை பொறுத்தவரை வெட் ப்ராசஸிங் ஹையஸ்ட்டு, டொமஸ்டிக் வாட்டரை பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் கார்மெண்டிங் ஹையஸ்ட்டு, கெமிக்கல்ஸை பொறுத்தவரை வெட் ப்ராசஸிங் ஃபார் ஷுவர் வெரி கிளியர் கெமிக்கல்ஸ் தான் வெட் ப்ராசஸிங் விச் இன்க்ளூட்ஸ் பிரிண்டிங் ஆல்சோ. எலக்ட்ரிசிட்டி பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் வெட் ப்ராசஸிங், கார்பன் எமிஷன் பொறுத்தவரை டையிங், மேன் பவர் கார்மெண்டிங். இதில் ஒரு ஸ்பெஷாலிட்டி பார்த்தீங்கன்னா அந்த டொமஸ்டிக் வாட்டர் இருக்கு இல்லையா, டொமஸ்டிக் வாட்டர் எண்ட் யூஸ் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 875 இருக்கும். எண்ட் யூஸ் கஸ்டமர் யூஸ் பண்ணுறாங்க இல்லையா, அவங்க தண்ணி அதிகமாக யூஸ் பண்ணுறாங்க. நம்மளோட நம்பர் ஆஃப் வாஷ், அது லைஃப் வாஷ். அதே போல் இபியும் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா எண்ட் யூஸ் வந்து நம்ம கார்மெண்ட்டுக்கு எவ்வளோ யூஸ் பண்ணுறோமோ 4.35 அந்த அளவுக்கு அவங்க யூஸ் பண்ணுறாங்க. ஸோ எண்ட் யூஸில் வந்து எல்லாம் பார்ப்பாங்க இது எதுக்குன்னா ஒரு ப்ராடக்ட் டிசைன் தேவைப்படும். நாளைக்கு வந்து அயனிங் பண்ணுறாங்க இல்லையா, ரிங்கிள் ஃப்ரீ பண்ணாங்கன்னா அயனிங் பண்ண தேவை இருக்காது. ஸோ எண்ட் யூஸோட ஈபியை குறைக்கலாம். ஸோ ப்ராடக்ட் டிசைனிங்லாம் அதெல்லாம் தேவைப்படும். ஸோ எல்சிஏ ஸ்டடி பண்ணும்போது எந்த ஸ்டேஜில் நம்ம என்ன கான்செப்ட் பண்ணணுங்கிறதுக்கான ஒரு கிளாரிட்டி கிடைக்கும். ஸோ இதெல்லாம் ஃபியூச்சரில் வந்து நிச்சயமாக வரும், எல்சிஏ ஸ்டடி எல்லாம் நிச்சயமாக வரும் உங்களுக்கு. ஸோ இப்போ நான் போட்ட ஆக்ஷன் பிளான் தான் இங்கே வந்து பாயிண்ட்ஸாக போட்டிருக்கேன். So LCA study gives you a picture which speaks about environmental, social, health and safety impact of a product right from its birth till the death. இங்கலா நீங்க வந்து கொஞ்சம் கூகுள்ல போய் பார்த்துட்டு பை ஷிப்ல அனுப்புறதுக்கும் பை ஏர்ல அனுப்புறதுக்கும் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா கார்பன் எமிஷன் 4 times இருக்கும், 4 times இருக்கும். இப்போ இங்கேருந்து தூத்துக்குடி போதுன்னா பை ரோட்ல அனுப்புறதுக்கும் பை ட்ரெயின்ல அனுப்புறதுக்கும் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா ஆல்மோஸ்ட் தெர்ஸ் சேவிங்ஸ் ஆஃப் மோர் தென் 30% பை ட்ரெயினில் போனச்சு சொன்னீங்கன்னா. அதே போல் உங்களோட ஸ்கோப் 3 எமிஷனில் பைக்கில் போகிறதுக்கும் உங்களோட கம்பெனி வெஹிக்கிளில் போகிறதுக்கும் வித்தியாசம் இருக்குது. இதெல்லாம் சின்ன ஸ்டடி பண்ணிங்கன்னா உங்கள் கம்பெனி சேவிங்ஸ் இருக்கிற இல்லையோ அட்லீஸ்ட் ஃபார் அவர் மதர் நேச்சர் ஃபார் அவர் வேர்ல்ட் இம்ப்ரூவ்மெண்ட் இருக்கேன். எஸ் சார். ஸோ இஃப் யூ ஹேவ் எனி க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் ஆன் எல்சிஏ ஐ வில் பி ஹாப்பி டு ஆன்சர் யூ.
ரொம்ப நன்றி சார், இது மாதிரி ஒரு அனலைஸ் பண்ணுறதுக்கு எங்களுக்கு ஒரு ஐடியா கொடுத்தது. ஆல்ரெடி பண்ணிட்டு தான் இருக்கோம், பட் இருந்தாலும் ஸ்டார்டிங் டு எண்ட் பண்ணல, அங்கங்கே பண்ணி வச்சுருக்கோம். இதை வந்து
ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் பார்த்தீங்கன்னா நம்ம சைக்கிள் செயினில் 96% வாட்டர் இஸ் யூஸ்ட் இன் ஃபீல்ட் ஃபார்மில் தான், பாக்கி 3% தான் நம்ம சப்ளை செயின் யூஸ் பண்ணுறோம் ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர். ஸோ உண்மையிலேயே ஸ்டடிலாம் பண்ணும்போது ஒரு நல்ல ஒரு அவுட் சைட் கிடைக்கும். உங்கள ஃப்ரெஷ் வாட்டர் வந்து பார்த்தீங்கன்னா என்ன பொறுத்தவரை கார்மெண்ட்ஸ்லையும் ஸ்பின்னிங்லையும் கார்மெண்ட் ஃபெசிலிட்டி உள்ளவங்களுக்கு தான் ஜாஸ்தி. ஸோ கான்சன்ட்ரேஷன்ஸ் ஏன்னா இபி பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் வெட் ப்ராசஸிங், கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் பொறுத்தவரை டையிங், மேன் பவர் சோஷியல் பொறுத்தவரை ஸ்பின்னிங் அண்ட் கார்மெண்டிங், ஏன்னா கார்மெண்டிங் நம்பர் ஆஃப் பீப்புள் அதிகமாக இருப்பாங்க. ஸோ இதெல்லாம் வந்து ஒரு கிவ்ஸ் யூ அவுட்லுக் சஸ்டைனபிலிட்டி ஆங்கிள். ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் நீங்கள் கண்டினியூஸ் டைங்கெலாம் போயிட்டு இருக்கீங்களேன், உங்கள் பவர் கன்சப்ஷன் ஆகட்டும் சரி, கார்பன் ஃபுட் பிரிண்ட் ஆகட்டும் சரி, கெமிக்கல் கன்சப்ஷன் ஆகட்டும் சரி, வேஸ்ட் ஜென்ரேஷன் ஆகட்டும் சரி, எல்லாமே குறைஞ்சிடும். டெக்னாலஜி வந்துருச்சு ஆனால் என்ன ஃபீஸிபிளாக இல்லை. ஸோ கண்டினியூஸ் டைங்கெலாம் போனீங்கன்னா சால்ட் இருக்காது, ஜிடிபி லோடு இருக்காது,
வாட்டர் கன்சம்ஷன்
ஒன் ஃபோர்த் ஆகிடும் ஜிடிபி லோடு இருக்காது. ஸோ ஆட்டோமேட்டிக்காக பவர் உங்களுக்கு இபி கம்மியாகும் உங்களுக்கு.
ஆக்சுவலாக வந்து சால்ட் தான் நமக்கு பெரிய பிரச்சனையாக இருக்குது.
ஆமாம், தென்மா மட்டும் லேங்கல்ல ஹசரஸ் வேஸ்ட்டில் சால்ட் இஸ் த மேஜர். ஏன்னா உங்களுக்கு வந்து ஈடிபி வேஸ்ட் கூட ஸ்லட்ஜு வந்து கூட வந்து மாதிரி கோஸ் அஸ் அ ரா மெட்டீரியல் ஃபார் சிமெண்ட் இண்டஸ்ட்ரி, அதை கூட வந்து நீங்கள் வந்து ஆக்சுவல் வேஸ்ட் சொல்ல முடியாது. சால்ட் தான் ஆக்சுவலாக பருக்கோடைய மெயின் வேஸ்ட். கேட்கலாம் இந்த ஒர்க் ஷாப்புக்கே நாங்கள் எதிர்பார்த்து 30 பேர் தான், 50 ரெஜிஸ்ட்ரேஷன் வந்துச்சு, அதுவே பெருசு தாங்க. இல்லை ஓகே, சரி, இந்த சப்ஜெக்ட் வந்து அவ்வளோ ஈஸி கிடையாது, அதெல்லாம் கிராஸ் பண்ணவும் முடியாது, அது விருப்பம் இருக்குன்னு அவசியம் கிடையாது. அதாவது வந்து சொல்லுவாங்களே ஹியூமன் நீட்ஸ் வந்து பேசிக் நீடு, உண்ண உணவு உடுத்த உடை இருக்கு இருப்பிடம், அந்த மூணும் முடிஞ்சதுக்கு அப்புறம் தான் அடுத்த லெவலுக்கு போவாங்க. திருப்பூரை பொறுத்தவரை இன்னும் அதிலே தான் சுற்றிட்டு இருக்கணும், உண்ண உணவு உடுத்த உடை இருக்கிட்டு தான் இருக்கும். இதெல்லாம் வந்து சாட்டிஸ்ஃபை ஆனால் தான் நம்ம அடுத்தது வந்து என்வரன்மெண்டல் ஆங்கிள்லையோ சஸ்டைனபிலிட்டி ஆங்கிள்லையோ பார்க்க முடியும். ஸோ ஆன் பிஹாப் ஆஃப் டி ஐ தேங்க் த லீட் டீம் ஹூ வாஸ் கம் ஆல் தி வே ஃப்ரம் சென்னை அண்ட் புனே, அண்ட் ரம்யா கண்டியூர் வாஸ் கம் ஆல் தி வே ஃப்ரம் கொச்சின். கேன் வி ஃபினிஷ் அப்